Hello, everyone. Why don't we stand and get started? It's good to be here tonight. It's good to be able to get together with family, isn't it? A little fellowship, a little rubbing shoulders. Let's ask the Lord's blessing on our night. Father, we come before you and we want to dedicate, set this time aside, Lord, recognizing you as our God, our Savior, our Redeemer, our friend. And so, Lord, we give ourselves to you again tonight. Have your way in your people here. Your will be done. Amen.
Thank you. Good evening. Welcome this Wednesday night, Calvary Chapel here, Clear Lake, and we are pleased to have you with us tonight. More than that, I'm sorry to say, we're pleased to be with God tonight, right? I mean, I like you and all. I love you, but I do definitely love him more. And yes, he is worthy. He is worthy of it all. So there are some things in the bulletin that you might want to check out from Sunday if you weren't here. There's a ladies' fellowship. There's a ladies' class that's starting up at the end of the month. And tonight we're going to be partaking in worship of the Lord through communion at the end of the service. So we're going to continue our worship and receive an offering at this time. Amen. Heavenly Father, we are so very gracious, Lord, to you. Lord, we thank you for touching our lives and our families. Lord, we pray for those who are sick among us in our body. Lord, those who are struggling with other things, Lord. And we pray, Lord, that you would lift them up out of the muck and the mire, Lord, that you would lift them up and hold them dear to you, close to your heart, O God. And we do adore you, Lord. And we thank you for this country. We thank you for this place that we have to worship you in Jesus' name.
Come let us worship. worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our God, our Maker, for He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture and the sheep of His hand, just the sheep of His hand. Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our God, our Maker. Come, let us worship and mercy, as deep cries out.
Father, we want to thank you for our time of worship and praise and adoration, Lord God. There's nothing like being one-hearted, one-minded, and one purpose, Lord, as a people to come into your presence and into your love, Lord God. And we enter in there because of Jesus, Father. We thank you for your Holy Spirit that's already been working and always been preparing us, Lord God. And Father, I know you have something mighty for us to know, Lord, to understand. So I pray, Lord, for the Holy Spirit to truly guide us in the Word of God and make us alive to us, Lord. Teach us, Lord God, as we soften ourselves before you, Lord God. In Jesus' name we pray, Father. Amen. Please be seated. Hopefully you all brought your Bibles tonight. I hope you did. Turn with me to the book of 2 Kings, chapter 23. 2 Kings, chapter 23. We're going to have to refresh a little bit because we've been out of the Kings for about 2 or 3 weeks. So going back there after Christmas time, Josiah became king. He's the king of Judah. That would be the southern kingdom. He is 8 years old. And the Bible says from that point on, when he became king, he did what was right in the sight of God. In other words, he did everything he believed and that he knew. Now, how much can you know at 8 years old? You can know some things, but he has some counselors, I have no doubt, who are teaching him the ways of God. So he's going along with their counseling and agreeing with their counseling, and he's doing everything that what he knows concerning God. The scriptures also teaches that he does everything and he walked in the ways of God like the king, or his father, David. That would be his grandfather, a little bit distant, more than a grandfather, probably a great-great-grandfather. But he did it all the ways that was right. And then he also did not turn to the right nor to the left. Now, what that means literally is that he stayed on the path that God wanted for his life. He didn't compromise what he believed. He stayed exactly what the truth was concerning the Word of God. Now you and I are going to have times in our lives, probably especially during the times that we live today and what's happening in our nation, and you're going to have to choose whether you're going to stay straight on the path, or whether you're going to go to the left or to the right. Now, it's not hard to know what's straight. It's not hard. God, through his word, teaches us exactly what the straight road. The Bible teaches, and Jesus made this statement, that narrow is the road that leads to God, but broad is the road that leads to destruction. So God wants us to know the straight road, narrow road, but he doesn't want us to deviate from the right to the left. Josiah was a young man, that stayed on the right path. Now, after 18 years of reigning, he orders his leaders, pulls his leaders together, the priests, the high priest, Shaphan the recorder, and he orders them to start to rebuild the temple. The temple is a place where God's presence was supposed to be known, where they were to meet God. It was a holy place, a sacred place, and it had been defiled and it had been neglected. Josiah, when he becomes king, he decides he's going to make sure that the house of God is in perfect order. And so he hires carpenters and he hires men to do the work of, and stonemasons to do the work that of repair and restore the temple. But while they're there, they find the Bible. Really, the book of the law, which are probably the five books of the Pentateuch, first five books of the Bible. And it kind of blows them away. Imagine this. And it's kind of really astounding that there is no Bible at this time, because every king was to have a Bible, and he was supposed to read it constantly so he would know what God said. But evidently, Josiah does not have a Bible. Imagine, and probably when you became a Christian, this happened to you, because it happened to me. I remember reading the Bible before I was a Christian. I didn't have to find the Bible. I just had the Bibles at my home. They were really good dust keepers. My parents were not Christians, but they had Bibles. So imagine this. You read the Bible. You really don't learn nothing from it, because I read the Bible, some, not the whole Bible, but I read different stories. And I said, this is a nice storybook. It tells good stories of what happened. But after you become born again and the Holy Spirit comes in and lives in you, the Bible says your spirit's reborn. Now your spiritual eyes are open. You can see. Imagine being a Christian for, say, 5 years, say 10 years, say 18 years. And all of a sudden, for the first time, somebody comes in and tells you, guess what we found? I found the Bible. It tells you everything what God wants you to do and how God wants you to act. And I mean, it's a perfect plan that God has. Boy, if it was me, I would say, this is awesome. Because I already know that if I've been his age, in his 20s, 25 years old, that I make a lot of bad choices. I've made a lot of bad choices by then. And here I have the book of life that's going to tell me how to live, how to be a good husband, how to be, at this point, a good king for him, how to walk with God, how to know God. I mean, it's the words of success, the words of life. And that's literally what happens to Josiah and to all these people. After Josiah finds out that they found this book, he sends some of his elders, six of them, to a prophetess named Huldah. And Huldah goes and seeks the Lord, and she comes back and she tells these men that are sent that God is going to send a judgment. And in a few years after we get through this chapter, a few years down the road from this, probably about 12, 13, maybe 15 years, literally God's judgment does happen. But it won't happen, the prophetess tells the elders, during the time of Josiah, because of what Josiah did. Josiah rips his clothes and repents. Josiah looks at the word of God and it blows him away. So the response of the heart of Josiah is so different. That's where we end it. But I want to say this before we go into God's word tonight. This chapter is literally about a king and a nation, God's people, that hear the word of God, heed the word of God, and repent because of the word of God. Josiah is going to be one man that is stirred by the word of God and stirred by the Spirit of God. And his heart is going to be broken before God. This nation will not be the same during his reign after this. Everything's going to change. Everything. And every area of the life of this nation is going to be affected. Every single area. And let me say this. When revival happens within a heart, it starts at one heart at a time, but it affects every area of that heart. True revival will bring true repentance to every area of our hearts. It's not one that comes in and says, you know what, I'm just going to scope this one out. Don't worry. And although God does work that way sometimes, but he'll just touch one area of your life and he'll say, this is what I want you to do. This is what I'm working on. This is what I want you to change. And I'm going to give you the ability to change that. But God, when he brings us to repentance, he shows a light on all within our hearts. And that's what's going to happen in this chapter. It's an awesome chapter. So let's see what verses 1 and 2 says. This is really, I put the heading of it, the beginning of the reform. Now the king sent them together, all the elders of Judah and Jerusalem, to him. The king went up to the house of the Lord with all the men of Judah, and with him all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, the priests, the prophets, and all the people, both small and great. And he read in their hearing all the words of the book of the covenant, which had been found in the house of the Lord. Well, the first thing that Josiah does is he gets convicted by the word of God. His heart gets changed. He becomes repentant. And then all of a sudden he begins to gather all the leaders of the people. Because in this, the affecting of the nation, it is not going to be just one person is going to do it. It's going to be the leaders that are going to be needed to have the same heart, the same revival to change the whole nation. I want you to look at our nation right now. Don't be discouraged. Don't be depressed because of what's happening. The Lord spoke to my heart today about that. He took me to Isaiah 41:10, and it says this, "Fear not, and be not dismayed." Those two things can happen to us so easily now in what we see what's happening. And this is what that scripture continues to say, "I will be with you. I will strengthen you. I will uphold you, and I will help you. And I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." So in other words, what God is saying here, and what's happening in our nation today, is God will give us whatever we need as Christians. But we need to depend on him. That's the key. We need to trust him. And he's willing. He's faithful. I've been a Christian for a long time, and God has been faithful in every area of the word of God in my life. That doesn't mean that I like some of the things that he's done or he's allowed. But in order for our nation to come back, and first of all, I don't believe it can come back, there would have to be all the leaders, all of our Congress and all of our senators, all our cabinet, the judicial system, the Supreme Court, would have to come to a place of true repentance, true turning away from sin to bring revival. And this is exactly, as you will see, as we go through all these verses, you're going to see that this whole nation of Judah repents and God restores them and revival happens. It may not happen to our nation, but it can happen to us individually, and it can happen to our church. But it takes everybody, it takes all the leadership, it takes everyone to become part of this. Many of you are leaders in our body today, and it takes you to join in revival concerning letting God work in your heart, being honest with the Word of God, and then, when needed, repentance, as we will see. A lot of times people just hear the Word of God. I know what it says, and I agree with you. But that's not what God entailed for the Word of God to do to you. Jesus said, and you will know the truth, and it will set you free. It doesn't say it'll go and it'll just stay on the tip of your tongue or on the top of your head and just stay there. It does something. The Word of God is a two-edged sword. So, we see that Josiah gathers the leadership first and all the inhabitants, those that are small and great. And the scripture says he goes to the book of the covenant. Verse 3 says, then the king stood by a pillar, or a platform, and made a covenant before the Lord. And here's what the covenant on their side said: to follow the Lord, to keep his commandments and his testimonies and his statutes with all his heart and with all his soul, and to perform the words of this covenant that were written in this book. And all the people took a stand for the covenant. So what Josiah does is he goes before God, brings all the people, and they make an agreement. Let me read to you what the Hebrew word is for covenant. An alliance with a friendship in mind, a covenant, a divine ordinance with signs and pledges. So in other words, this covenant is that they are going to agree with God that they're going to do certain things that they say they're going to do. And they are to be kept concerning the covenant. Their agreement is to keep his commandments, to keep his testimonies, his statutes, and to do that with all their hearts. Now, let me read to you or give you a little bit more information concerning some of these covenants that God says here. The covenant was that they should walk after the Lord, the first one, in compliance with his will, in his ordinances and his providences. So they are to walk with God, and this is their agreement. Remember, this is what God wants. This is what God worked with. But they're the ones who came to God that made this covenant. God didn't say, this is what you need to do. God already had told them that. They had already been told through their prophets and through the Word of God, through Moses. They already knew that. But they had deviated from them, forsaken them, and now they're coming back and they're bringing this covenant to God. And this is what the covenant is. Walking with God, number one. Answering his calls and attending to all his motions, that they should make consciousness of all his commandments and moral, ceremonial, and judicial, and should carefully observe them with all their hearts and all their souls. So they're making a covenant with God that they're going to obey God. But let me tell you why. Because they love God. What can happen to us as a Christian, if we've been Christian for a period of time, is we can become people who are religious with no emotion or no feelings or no passion. And what God wants is He wants a relationship with us. That's what we have. We are not a religious people. We're to have ones that who are relationship. And in that relationship, God wants us to obey Him. Not because we have to. Not because He's going to be angry at us. Not because He's going to call fire down from heaven. That isn't why God wants you to obey Him. But God wants you to obey Him because you love Him. That's a piece of motivation. Now, people have said this. I love God. And in their life, there's not a lot of obedience to the Word of God. And here's what Jesus said. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. You're going to make mistakes at times. You're going to fall short, like everybody. But you're going to repent right away. So they were to obey God and His commandments with this covenant because they loved God. That's what God wanted. Now, let me give you another reason why God wanted them to obey Him. Everything God says is perfect for our lives. If I want a perfect marriage, all I have to do is follow the Word of God. I didn't say that the Word of God is easy to do. Because a lot of times the Word of God means dying to myself and allowing God to live through me or love through me or whatever that may be. But if I want a great marriage, I don't have to go to books. I don't have to read 10 books about marriage. I remember, and I shared it with you a long time ago, a man and a woman wrote a book on marriage. And their qualifications was this, they stated. He has been married 5 times, and I have been married 5 times, so we have 10 marriages to glean from. That makes sense, huh? No. If you weren't successful in those, how are you going to be successful in telling me how to be successful? Not very wise. My point is, if I want to have a good marriage, all I have to do is go to the Bible. It tells me. God is the one who invented marriage. He tells me how to have a successful marriage. If I want to be a successful man in the business, the Bible teaches me how to be a successful man. If I want wisdom, the Bible teaches me how to get wisdom. You see, everything I need is there. And God wants my life to be blessed. I shared with a young man a couple days ago, and I said, you know what? God has a plan for your life, and it's not this. But let me tell you, the devil comes to rob and kill and destroy, and he's doing a good job in your life right now. And he agreed. He agreed. And I said, won't you follow God's plan for your life now? But I said, God has so many blessings in mind. I said, you're almost at the end of your rope right now. And he says, I'm not quite there yet. And I said, okay, so you got a little bit to go. And he goes, oh, yeah, I guess so. And the Bible says here, and all the people took a stand for the covenant. In other words, they all agreed together. So let's say this. I was to say to you tonight, we're going to make a covenant with God. And the covenant is we're going to keep God's commands. The covenant is we're going to keep God's statutes. And we're going to obey God because we love Him. Now, when I'm all done saying that to you, you stand up and you say, okay, I'm going to do it. I agree with it. Or you could just sit down and say, I like what Pastor said tonight. Pretty good. Sounded good. Even convicted me. I kind of felt bad. That's not what the Holy Spirit wants you to feel bad. But what He does want you to do is He wants you to turn your heart toward Him. And that's exactly what they did. They all agreed with Him, and they stood up and made a stand. Okay, we agree with the covenant. It says here, then the king stood by a pillar and made a covenant before the Lord to follow the Lord. So he himself, the king himself, stood up also and said, you know what? This is what we're going to do. This is how it's going to be. This had to be a special work of the Holy Spirit. The Bible teaches that there are times when the Holy Spirit comes upon a people as a group. God works individually in every single heart, and then he works at times in a whole group of people at once. God may speak to all of you the exact same thing with the same thing in mind. Again, the Bible tells us that there are times when the Holy Spirit comes upon a people as a group, which is a different work than individual filling of the Holy Spirit. There are times when the Holy Spirit seems to work on a group as we pray for such a movement of the Holy Spirit today. I want to give you a couple of examples of this. One is in the book of Acts, chapter 2, verse 4. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with tongues, with other tongues, that the Spirit gave them utterance. Let me give you a couple more. Acts 4:31. And when he had prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. Acts 10:44. While Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit fell upon all those who heard the word. You see, I believe that there are times that God does work like that, that the Holy Spirit works on every single heart that's in that room and does something very special. Okay, let me say what I believe, and you can disregard this if you want to. But I believe that God's going to do that tonight, and God's doing that in your heart tonight. But let me tell you what I believe he's doing. I believe that what he's going to do is he's going to convict you, and he's going to bring to your heart a place where he desires for you to repent. Because we are going to see the things that this king is going to do that are going to be amazing things that he's going to get rid of and deal with. And there are things in many of Christians' hearts today that they never really deal with concerning sin that needs to be repented of, sin that they think is not sin, that God says is sin, or sin that they just pushed aside. I know that what I'm doing is not right, but I don't care because I'm okay with it. I'm okay in so many other areas. And when God works on us for repentance, it is never in any way but out of a heart of love. In the scripture, in the book of Hebrews 12, it says that God chastens who he loves. God is not angry at you tonight in any way. But God wants to work you and free you from something. That's what God desires. Now, he goes on in verse 3, and the king commanded Hilkiah, the high priest, the priest of the second order, and the doorkeeper to bring out the temple, the Lord of all the articles that were made for Baal, for Asherah, and for all the hosts of heaven. And he burned them outside Jerusalem in the fields of Kidron, and he carried their ashes to Bethel. So he is going to go into the temple, and he's going to be removing idols, false gods, Asherah, Baal. You see, what had happened is that Manasseh had allowed different things to happen, and so did other kings. And literally, they were put in the house of God that were to be set apart for only God and God Himself. So they had many idols. Would it be easy to remove those idols? When we look at a king, we think he's has power and there's nothing he can't do. That's not true. First of all, every single king, especially godly king, has another king. His name is Jesus. He had to be under the control of God, and that's why he had to know the Word of God and what God said. That way he could do the Word of God. And he has all these leaders who have gone along with this already. This is a normal thing. It's been going on for years and years. And think how the people might react. Wait a minute, he's taking away all these gods, or taking away all these. I worship that god. I go to that god's important to me. But Josiah knows what he needs to do, and it's not an easy thing, but he has to remove all the idols from the house of God. Now let's go to the New Testament just for a moment. When a person becomes Christian, the Bible says that literally Jesus comes in and lives in that heart. The Holy Spirit enters. And now the Bible says you are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Now God lives in you. And when God comes in, darkness removes, and now there's light. But we can, just like these people of God, allow idols to come into our hearts that we worship. And God says, I don't want no idols. I don't want no other gods in the temple. Now, when we look at the idols here, we look at false gods. Statues made out of silver, gold, stone. But the ones that can be in our hearts can be totally different, and we may not think that they are idols. Money can be a god. Sex can be a god. A person can be a god. Power can be a god. They can become idols, and we can worship them and still think that God is okay with it. We can be dishonest with ourselves concerning gods. I have to search my heart on a regular basis just to make sure my heart is clear and clean. I don't want to put no one or nothing before God. So he goes in there, does all these removing of them, but then he burns them. He burns them up with fire and makes them dust, so to say. Verse 3, then he removes all the idolatrous priests whom the king of Judah had ordained to burn incense on the high places in the cities of Judah and in the places all around Jerusalem, and those who burned incense to Baal, to the sun, to the moon, to the constellations, and to all the hosts of heaven. So we look at these things that are happening, and there were priests that literally were supposed to be chosen by God, and they weren't, and they were put in places of where they were literally bringing false worship and leading God's people to false worship. Kind of a mind blower. Now, some of these would be, like the host of heaven, would be astrology. Don't raise your hand, but do any of you play around with astrology? Not astronomy. Astronomy is a study of stars, the universe. I'm talking about astrology. reading your signs. What is your sign, buddy? I had someone ask me that not too long ago. And I said, it's a cross, Jesus. Verse 6, and he brought out the wooden images from the house of the Lord to the brook of Kidron outside Jerusalem, burned it on the brook of Kidron and ground it into ashes, and threw the ashes on the graves of common people. Then he tore down the ritual booths of the perverted or the Sodomites, persons that were in the house of the Lord, or the women who wove hangings for the wooden image. This word, it speaks about perverted or Sodomite, has two meanings, or really three meanings. It can mean the worship of sacred prostitutes. It can mean homosexuality. It does in the book of Genesis. And it can mean bestiality. So he destroyed all of these things that were happening, that were permitted concerning the house of the Lord. I want to share this with you. We've got to make sure that we're careful of what we believe is okay in the house of the Lord. I believe what the Bible teaches, that any person can come to Christ, that no person is, the Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever should believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God loves everyone. God has made a way for every person to be saved, and the payment of sin has been paid. They must receive it. And there's no sin that's too big for God to forgive and to cleanse and to free. But I also believe that what the Word of God says, there must be repentance in the area of sin. And what God calls sin is sin. Not what man calls sin is sin, but God. And God calls sodomy sin, homosexuality. It's sin. I just heard today that they are trying to sue the United States, the homosexual community, and get repayment because for years the United States would not allow them to be get married. So they want to be paid for that from our government. Who knows if it will pass? But these are the things that he had to deal with and get rid of. Who knows if he had to deal with relatives that had were in these kind of things, in these kind of sins? Who knows? Being a king, you had lots of relatives, and I'm sure that they were involved in a lot of different things, but he couldn't show favoritism to his family or his friends. He had to stand on the Word of God. And at times, that's not easy. As parents, as grandparents, I know what they want to do, but I'm not allowing that because that's what God says. I'm going to do the opposite. Verse 10, and that he defiled Topheb, which is in the valley of the son of Hinnom, and no man might make his son and daughter to pass through the fire of Moloch. It's hard to believe that anybody would allow their children, firstborn especially, to be put on the altar of a statue that's put in the fire that's burning and allow them to be put on there and burned as a sacrifice. And then the drums would play so the sound of the squealing of the baby would not be heard and they could party. That's pretty heavy, isn't it? But that's exactly what was happening. And this is exactly what Josiah said. This ain't happening no more. It's over. Then he removed the horses of the kings of Judah had dedicated to the sun. This is a mind blower. Look what's happening right before the temple of God. At the entrance of the house of the Lord, by the chamber of Nathmelech, the officer was in the court, and he burned the chariots of fire with fire, the altars that was on the roof, the upper chamber of Ahaz, the kings of Judah had made, and the altars which Manasseh had made in the two courts of the house of the Lord. The king broke down and pulverized there, and threw their dust in the brook of Kidron. What they had is they had horses, and they had chariots, and these men would drive them out to every morning, they'd say, to worship the sun god, right there in the house of God before you walked in. That's heavy. But Josiah burns them all up and removes them all. Verse 13, then the king defiled the high places that were east of Jerusalem, which were on the south of the Mount of Corruption, which Solomon, king of Israel, had built from Ashdod, the abomination of the Sidonians, the Chesmos, the abomination of the Moabites, for Milcham, the abomination of the people of Ammon, and he broke them in pieces, the sacred pieces, and cut down the wooden images, and he filled the places with the bones of men. So he goes and he removes all these gods and all these ones that the people have brought in and allowed to be in the house of God, in the temple of God, and he removes them all. I'm sure that there were a lot of people who were very upset with Josiah at this point. And I'm sure that there were a lot of people that were for him, in agreement with it. A remnant, I believe. Verse 15, moreover, the altar that was in Bethel, and the high places which Jeroboam the son of Nebat, which made Israel sin, had made. Both that altar and the high place he broke down, and he burned the high places, and he crushed it with powder, and he burned the wooden images. Jeroboam was one of the first kings of the northern, he was the first king of the northern kingdom. This had been going on for probably 200 to 300 years at least. The worship up in the high places. So it was really well established concerning God's people. But Josiah said, I don't care how long this has been going on. It ends today. And he goes in there and destroys it all. He's about 26 years old. That's all he is. But he's by the Spirit of God being led, and he knows what the Word of God says, and he won't negate it in any way. Verse 16, and Josiah turned. He saw the tombs that were there on the mountain, and he sent and he took the bones out of the tombs, and he burned them on the altar, and he defiled it according to the word of the Lord, which the man of God proclaimed, who proclaimed these words. Then he said, what gravestone is this that I see? Well, the men, the city have told him, it is a tomb of the man of God who came from Judah and proclaimed these things which you have done against the altar of Bethel. And he said, let me him alone. Let no one move his bones. So they let his bones alone, and the bones of the prophets who came from Samaria. So God had already told to this prophet, to Jeroboam, first king, 200 or 300 years before, when he built this altar, there's going to be a man named Josiah who's going to come and he's going to burn and destroy these altars. That tells me that God knows everything way before it happens. And God's purpose and plan cannot be stopped, and it will be fulfilled. This was spoken of in 1 Kings 13, 1 and 2. Verse 19, and then Josiah also took away all the shrines of the high places that were in the cities of Samaria, which the kings of Israel had made to provoke the Lord to anger. And he did to them according to all the deeds he had done to Bethel. He executed all the priests of the high places that were there on the altar, and he burned men's bones on them, and he returned to Jerusalem. Then he commanded all the people, saying, keep the Passover to the Lord your God, as was written in this book of the covenant. So the Passover now is something they were to celebrate. They were supposed to go to three feasts a year, and they haven't been doing this at all because they don't have the Bible. They don't have the book, partly. He goes on, verse 22, such a Passover surely had never been since the days of the judges who judged Israel, nor in all the days of the kings of Israel and the kings of Judah. But in the 18th year of King Josiah, this Passover was held before the Lord in Jerusalem. So, we see this great celebration, and it's been probably one of the greatest ever concerning God's people, celebrating the feast of the Passover. Verse 24, moreover, Josiah put away those who consulted mediums, spiritists, household gods, idols, all the abominations that were seen in the land of Judah and in Jerusalem, that he might perform the words of the law, which he was written in the book that Hilkiah the priest found in the house of the Lord. Josiah didn't miss one little article, one little tittle of God's word. Everything that God says, he allowed it to happen, and he performed what God said he was supposed to perform. That's pretty heavy, isn't it? Now, verse 25, before him, there was no king like him who turned to the Lord with all his heart and with all his soul and with all his might according to all the law of Moses, nor after him did any arise like him. So Josiah, following the law, was unparalleled among all the kings of Israel and all of Judah. Like his grandfather Hezekiah, who was famed for being without equal in the trust of the Lord, Josiah was truly a righteous king. Because of their outstanding examples of godliness, the author of Kings and Chronicles devoted considerable space to this man and his reign. David was a great king. Josiah was a great man. There's a difference. I like what it says here. He turned to the Lord with all his heart. I believe that that's what God desires from us. God doesn't want us to be half-heartedly committed to him. Stop and think for a second. Please look at me. Stop and think for a second. Was there ever a time in your life as a Christian that you were more committed to God than now? Was there ever a time in your life that you were more in love with God than you are now? And if there is, or there was, then you need to come back to a place of falling back in love with God. One of the things that God speaks about in the Church of Ephesus, and I know you know well, is that they were going to church and they were doing all the right things and reading and serving the Lord, but one thing was missing, God said. He said, I'm glad you're doing all these things, but I have this against you. You left your first love. You're not in love with me like you used to be. But he gives them the antidote. He says to them, go and do the things you used to do when you were in love with me. Pray like you used to pray. Read your Bible like you used to read your Bible. Sing to me like you used to sing to me. Worship me at home like you used to. When you used to write poems about me and songs about me, do that again and it will return. Josiah made the law his rule and kept that in his eye throughout this reformation. I want to read to you the 4 points from Matthew Henry, talking about this same thought. It says here, number one, that he turned to the Lord from whom his father has revolted. It is true religion to turn to God as one we have chosen and love. He did what he could to turn the kingdom also to the Lord. Number two, he did this with his heart and soul. His affections and aims were right in what he did. Those make nothing of the religion that do not make a heart work of it. Number three, that he did, it was all heart and all soul and all might with vigor and courage and resolution. He could not otherwise have broken through the difficulty he had to grapple with. What great things may we bring to pass in the service of God if we but lively and heartily are in it. And four, that he did this according to the law of Moses and the exact observance of what that law and what an accurate regard to it was. His zeal did not transport him into any irregularities, but it as it did, he walked by rule. Goes on, and we're almost done. Nevertheless, verse 26, the Lord did not turn from his fierceness of his great wrath, with which his anger was aroused against Judah, because of all the provocations of which Manasseh had provoked him. And the Lord said, I will also remove Judah from my sight, as I have removed Israel, and will cast off this city, Jerusalem, which I have chosen, and the house of which I stand, my name shall be there. So God had made a promise, because they have sown bad seed for so long. And Manasseh was a big one. He was king for over 50 years, and he did a lot of bad things, even though he repented. God says there's still going to be a judgment, and they will be taken into captivity. They will go to Babylon as captives, and that's where you look at Daniel, and you see Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego. Those men are taken, and about 10,000 more. That's the first taking of them. It'll be another. Verse 28, now the rest of the acts of Josiah and all that he did, are they not written in the books of the Chronicles of the kings of Judah? In his day, Pharaoh Necho, king of Egypt, went to the aid of the king of Assyria and to the river Euphrates, and King Josiah went against him. And Pharaoh Necho killed him in Megiddo when he confronted him. Then his servants moved his body in a chariot from Megiddo, brought him to Jerusalem, and buried him in his own tomb. And the people of the land took Jehoahaz, the son of Josiah, anointed him, and made him king in his father's place. Now look at me, I want to tell you a story. The same story that we're on right now. Pharaoh Necho had been king of Egypt probably about 6 months. He was more or less friends with Assyria, and he was going down to help Assyria. Josiah hears of it, and he decides he's going to go and fight Pharaoh Necho. He meets Pharaoh Necho, and Pharaoh Necho says, and he speaks of this in the book of Chronicles, and he tells him, look, God has sent me down to do this. Don't mess with me, man. And he doesn't say, in other words, I'm paraphrasing it. He says, you need to go home. We don't need to fight. And Josiah decides, you know what? Mm-mm. I'm taking you on. And he ends up dying because of it. He shortens his reign because he goes against God. And Pharaoh was telling the truth. God had sent him, but he wouldn't listen. And so he put his nose where it shouldn't be. He took on somebody else's business that was not his. What's my point? There are times that we can take on things that we need to stay away from. You know, I've found it to be true that when you hear one side of the story, it seems right, until you hear the other half, then you get the complete truth and the complete story. Now, I'm not saying you don't defend other Christians. I'm not saying that at all. But I am saying this. The Bible does speak about this, about minding your own business. You know, and we have this thing called Facebook. We have this thing called texting and all these things that we can talk and we can hear about other people, and we can even take on other people's problems. We can take on our own kids' problems. Someone says something bad about my kid. Okay, that jerk, you don't like my kid, I don't like them, forget you. And you get angry and you get, you understand what I'm saying? This can happen so easy today, more than ever. He lost his life because of it. I believe that he could have lived longer and God's people could have prospered more. But he lost his life because he was trying to take on another person's problems. I've learned also to pray a lot. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything through prayer. We need to pray for people and not try to fix everything for people and not put ourselves in the place of where we need not to be. Because we're going to harm ourselves. And that's exactly what happens to him. But he loses his life. His son becomes king. Verse 31, Jehoahaz was 23 years old when he became king, and he reigned 3 months. Boy, that was a long time, in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Humatol, the daughter of Jeremiah of Libna, and he did evil in the sight of the Lord according to all that his fathers had done. Now Pharaoh Necho put him in prison in Riblah, in the land of Hamath, and that he might not reign in Jerusalem. And he imposed on the land a tribute of 100 talents of silver and a talent of gold. Then Pharaoh Necho made Eliakim, the son of Josiah, king in his place, and his father Josiah. And he changed his name Jehoiakim, and the Pharaoh took Jehoahaz and went to Egypt, and he died there. Now, because of him doing what he did, Josiah, he puts his whole country in jeopardy, and more or less, Judah becomes a vassal for Egypt. And verse 35 will end with that. So Jehoiakim gave the silver and gold to Pharaoh, but he taxed the land to give money according to the commandment of Pharaoh. He exacted the silver and gold from the people of the land, from everyone according to his assessments, to give it to Pharaoh. Jehoiakim was 25 years old when he became king, and he reigned 11 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name is Zubidah, the daughter of Pedaiah of Rumah. And he did evil in the sight of the Lord according to all that his fathers had done. So we see some short reigns now. But I want you to notice this man named Josiah. He makes a covenant with God, finds the word of God. I should say, finds the word of God, makes a covenant with God, and then applies the word of God in every area of his kingdom. The most godly king that we know of, more godly than David. David, like I said, was a great man, a great king, but Josiah was a great man. There's a difference. He followed the word of God, and literally, every time he saw something that was in the word of God, and he saw the opposite happening in his kingdom, he repented. In other words, he changed it. He turned the other way. What can we learn from Josiah? What is God working in our hearts tonight concerning this? Whenever we go to the word of God, God is going to, at times, reprove us. That's just part of what God does. Because there are times that we stray. There are times we allow things to happen within our hearts that God wants to change because he loves us. My grandchildren are good examples. I love all my grandchildren. I have 8. And there are times, my grandson the other day was, oh my gosh, crying because he couldn't have his way. And it was driving me nuts. And I wanted to correct him gently because I love him. I don't want him to turn out where he's spoiled rotten. God, in his greatness, is much greater than that in his love for us. So God allows us to see things and shows us things that we need to deal with and repent of. That God wants us to turn 180 degrees around, but that's what repentance is, a complete turning around from the way that we're going in the area of our life and turn toward him and his will. So bow your hearts tonight. We have the Lord's Supper, but worship team, just stay where you are for one moment. Bow your hearts to the Lord this tonight and ask God, is there anything in me tonight, Lord, that you want me to turn away from, that you have already even shown me today, maybe in the Word of God, that I need to turn towards you, God? Is there any idols that I have in my heart, God? Because I want to stand, God, just like the people did concerning the green with that covenant. That I want to obey you, God, and in your word, by the power of your Holy Spirit, God. Not by my might, Lord God, for my might is weak, Lord God. And if there's something that God has spoken to you, I want you to close your eyes and keep them closed, and I want you to stand tonight. Because what you're going to do is you're going to stand with me, because I want to do the same thing. I want to make agreement before God that anything he wants to do in me, I don't care who it is, he wants to show me, I want to repent of, if I need to repent of anything. So if God has spoken to you something, then stand tonight. And whatever that is tonight, when God shows us things, first of all, we need to confess them. That's admitting that God is right and I'm wrong. God, forgive. And then God requires for me to turn away. He gives me the power, the ability to turn away from that sin, or turn away or get rid of the idol or whatever it may be. That the temple of God that may be clear and clean. So Father, tonight we stand in the covenant we've made through Jesus Christ, Lord God. Not this old covenant, but a new covenant. We stand in the grace of God and the mercy of God. But we stand, Father, as your children. And Father, we desire for nothing to be in our heart that is contrary to you, Lord God. We desire for nothing to be in our life that's contrary to you, Lord God. And if we've brought anything into our hearts, God, we confess right now and we receive forgiveness and cleansing, God. And Father, as we saw our reformation, God, this was the starting point. Josiah went from thing to thing to thing to thing, Lord God. And this is what you may do in us, Lord God. But we want to stand for the Word of God, the complete Word of God, Lord. And whatever you want to do in us and whatever changes you want to make, please do them, Lord. From this night on, Lord God, may you continue that great work in us, Lord God. And Father, I don't know how we can say thank you, Lord. I guess mainly just by doing, by the power of the Holy Spirit, what you've called us to do, Lord God, and the covenant that we've made with you tonight, Lord God. So thank you, Father, what you've done in us tonight. May this, Father, be the beginning of what your will is and the fire that you desire within us, Lord God. In Jesus' name we pray, Father. Amen. Please be seated. Now our worship team can come up. Tonight we do the Lord's Supper. It's always an honor to do the Lord's Supper. I'm amazed that we can partake of the Lord's Supper. But God has made it a way for us to remember what it costs Him to pay for your sins, no matter what they are. When we partake of the bread, we remember the body that was broken. When we partake of the juice, remember the blood that was shed. The Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. The Bible says before we are to partake of the Lord's Supper to remember what God has done, that we are to examine ourselves. And some of you may have already done that. But there's nothing that God cannot forgive. There's nothing that God cannot cleanse. There's nothing that God cannot set free with us as His children. So real quickly, fathers, again, if there's anything we need to confess to You, God, may we confess it, God, and receive forgiveness, Lord God. And may You cleanse us and wash us from the guilt and condemnation of sin. And Father, thank You, for You're the only one that can forgive man his sins, Lord God. So we do remember what it cost You, Your Son, Jesus, and the price that He paid because of Your great love, Father, for us. In Jesus' name, amen. We ask that you stand up and go to the back and get the Lord's Supper, bring it back, and then we'll take it together as our worship team plays.
And did my sorrow die?
given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Take, eat." In the same manner, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Take, drink." Let us stand tonight. If you need prayer, we'd love to pray for you. Let's close in prayer real quickly. Father, I want to thank you for bringing your people here tonight, Lord God. And I want to thank you for what you did in our heart tonight, Lord. For the things that we desire, Lord, are the things that only you can do, Lord. The changes that you can make within us can only be done by you, Lord. As we surrender our hearts to you, Lord, you do those things, Lord. So thank you for that, Lord. And thank you that we serve the living God. One that sits on the throne, one that controls all things, one that tells us and commands us to fear not, to be not dismayed. For you will strengthen us and you will help us and you will uphold us with your righteous right hand. So we thank you for those truths, Lord God. Now bless your people, Father, wherever they go. And Father, I ask that you would use each one of us to share the gospel this week with someone, Lord, to invite to your house, whatever it may be. Please use us in a special way, Lord God. In Jesus' name we pray, Father. Amen. I want to remind you, on Sunday, we're going to be teaching on the Great Tribulation. So I want to encourage you to invite somebody. It's important that you do that. Please do that, okay? God bless you. Have a great night.